Hey, folks. Frank the Pest Geek here. Answering your questions. I am getting a lot of questions that I get messaged to me all the time. I get people message me privately about certain matters. By the way, I'm having today I'm having a Cohiba Havana Cuba with a singleton, single malt. It's called Luscious Nectar 12. 12-year-old single malt scotch. Put a little bit of ice in it. Soften it up a bit. It's like honey in your mouth. So I'm thinking of doing a segment called Ask the Pest Geek, because I get a lot of questions asked that people won't ask in the group, that they won't ask in other groups, that they won't dare to ask, you know, because he says, you know, I want to ask you a question directly because then I'll get a million different answers and I have no idea who to trust. You're always a straight shooter. Well, I give you the what I know. I don't know if I have the right answer. I'll tell you why I do it and why I don't do it. And here we are. Oh, wait a minute. I got to cut this out here. Hold on a second. Cut the pin off here. That's a little tight. Dang, torcedor is in Cuba. Can't roll a cigar anymore. But the flavor is totally different from any other flavor of any cigar in the world, and Cuban, including Cuban seed cigar grown in the Dominican Republic, doesn't taste the same because they don't have the same soil, they don't have the same weather. You know, it's kind of like, you know, Esteli is, you know, you have a pure Nicaraguan puro, tastes totally different. I actually don't like too many Dominican cigars. I tend to do more of I like some Hondurans. I like mostly Nicaraguans, but when I get my hands on these, I enjoy them. This is one of those, yeah, bad boy, like, that I'm going to have to light a couple times. Because the drag, it's a little tight on the draw. But I get a call this morning, and a message. Sometimes I'll get calls, and they make, and I ask you a quick question. You know, a lot of times I'm swamped, but this Saturday morning I'm taking a break. I'm not doing anything. And, you know, this was from James. James, you know who you are. I told you I'm going to use it. I'm not going to reveal who James is because he didn't want to ask in the group because, you know, a lot of people will say stupid and mean things in groups when somebody asks a sincere question, and then they don't give you a real answer. And most of the time, I talk to guys about motive action and rotating chemical active ingredients. So many people out there have no clue about motive action. I have an entire podcast. Go look for it. I'm going to put a link down below on motive action. You need to understand motive action, but you understand when you're dealing with repellents and non-repellents, when you're using baits together. We use a ton of non-repellents. Very little pyrethroids do I only use two right now. Proflex for mosquito misting when we do mosquito misting because we're using mostly Intucare and we're using bait, ATSB. So, you know, we use mostly non-repellents because we have to use so many baits in combination for our services. In order to be eco-friendly, we don't want to contaminate our baits. We don't want to have to come back a week later, you know, like everybody says, oh, just do flushing, you know, and then you come back a week later and you bait. Seems like a wasted trip to me. He says, and this was at 12:38, I was doing lunch this morning, I was preparing lunch. And I want to thank Lorraine. I don't know who she is, but she makes an amazing quiche. So I want to thank Lorraine for her quiche. I made a keto stovetop quiche Lorraine this morning. No crumbs, no bake. But man, was it good! It's almost like an omelet, like a deep dish omelet. But it's the quiche without the carbs. Quiche without carbs. Keto quiche. So he says, I watched your training video on roaches some time ago. I have a question. While applying a non-repellent such as Alpine WSG for the treatment of German roaches, when would you decide to use an IGR? I know I could post this on a page, but I figured I would just get direct answer from you without the BS. That's the way it is in a lot of groups. Thanks in advance. So my answer is, if you're going to use, okay, if you're going to use a product like Alpine, Dinotefuran, which, you know, before it was Alpine, before we used it was called Safari. You know, that thing was $300 for a 16-ounce bottle. So we're very familiar with it because we were using it in ornamentals before it was used in labeled for residential use for cracking crevice. Now, it's not for broadcast. It's for cracking crevice spot treatments inside the home. It's considered a reduced-risk product because of the way you apply it, not because the active ingredient is reduced risk. It is a neonicotinoid. Class 4. Non-repellent. So, when would I use it? I would use it immediately if I'm gonna use it, okay? And you can use it in combination with bait without a problem. I would use the IGR together, mixed together with it immediately as a cracking crevice, if you're gonna crack in crevice. I would go right back and bait. And you can do it right there. It's not gonna contaminate the bait. Why? Because they put the same IGR inside bait. And the non-repellent dinotefuran, which is Alpine WSG, is the same active ingredient used in rotation 1 and rotation 2, I think BASF, roach bait. It's a non-repellent. So if you got fipronil, it's a non-repellent. Imidacloprid is a non-repellent. Dinotefuran is a non-repellent. I don't think it's available in it, which used to be Meridian, which has been taken off the market, is a non-repellent. There's a bunch of non-repellent. All neonicotinoids are non-repellent. Class 22s, fiprils, they're non-repellents. Abamectin, non-repellents. So you can use it together with your roach bread. The reason he asked me, why don't I use it? It's not that I'm against cracking crevice. It's not that it's bad or you shouldn't do it. There is a reason why we personally don't do cracking crevice treatment for German roaches. And it is because we sell a unique selling proposition. We guarantee the customer that we have a non-disruptive service that will not contaminate their dishes, that will not contaminate their spoons, that they can stay there while we do it. They don't have to leave. So we're selling a non-disruptive service, and we're usually selling against something else, which is what the client tells me all the time. It says, this company says they'll do it cheaper, but I got to remove all of my plates. I got to remove all of my everything out of the cabinets. I got to take everything out. Imagine you've got 22 linear feet of cabinet, top and bottom, and the technician wants you to remove everything, have everything all over the counters, everything all over the table somewhere, so that he can go in, do a crack and crevice, he can do all this, and then you got to put it all back, and then he tells you, oh, by the way, you got to do that again in 7 to 14 days. It's very disruptive. The reason we figured out is we can do a bait service with point source IGR, use Advert, or now we use the new Precision Doxim system, include MaxForce Complete, and now we cover German cockroach and American cockroach in one shot. Nothing to be removed. As a matter of fact, the roaches will contaminate their dishes and contaminate their plates and contaminate their pots and pans more than I ever will do in my service, because it doesn't come in contact with anything. We don't have to do cracking crevice. It is double labor. It is more labor intense to do the cracking crevice than it is to do the bait and weight. There is a benefit. If you want a quicker knockdown, then we would do it. What we find in our service is we don't use cracking crevice. We don't use flushing. If we got a severe case, we're going to go with vacuum and air in the most severe case. We're going to flush out everything with vacuum and air. It's going to take a little longer, but I don't have to come back because I don't have to do the pyrethrum flushing, wait a week, and then come back and do the baiting. To me, it's self-defeating. It's time. The customer is buying your time and your expertise. So, is there a time when I would do a cracking crevice with Alpine and an IGR and the bait and the air flushing and the whole thing, is if I was doing a commercial restaurant? Because we got to get that knockdown quickly so that they can reopen. We got to get the control quickly so they can reopen, possibly in 24 to 48 hours if they're shut down. Or if they got a serious situation where the inspector's coming back, we want to make sure that that's cleaned out. So again, it has to do with application. It has to do with location. It has to do with scenario. We make a brand promise. And we figured out how to do this because we tested it for 3 years in HUD-infested units. Did it take longer? Yes. The problem was that there was asthma involved, and since it was a trial and a study, they didn't want us to use any sprays or any crack and crevice. Bait only, IGR only, monitors, and, you know, dust bait inside voids. That was the limit. We proved our concept works because we tested it in the battlefield in the most extensive environment. So it's not that I'm against, and I'm definitely against baseboard spraying. We haven't baseboard sprayed a house. Going on, geez, I'm losing track here. I think I stopped spraying in 2007. After we bought, back then we bought the System 2. I think it's System 2. It was from, what do you call it? They merged. They're no longer around. Oh. Geez, I lost it. The company that made advanced gel bait originally, we bought their cracking crevices. And we also bought the B&G cracking crevices. So we did do cracking crevice. Then we figured out with Ant Control that it was an extra step that we could eliminate in the process and still give the customer the same control. We figured out that the time savings of not doing a cracking crevice treatment saved us a ton of time, reduced the amount of pesticide in that home, because what we're fanatical about is the reduction of pesticide in the home. So we figured out we didn't even have to do cracking crevice, that it was just an extra step that added an extra cost. We're about implementing Lean and Six Sigma, and look up Lean and how it mostly is. Comes from manufacturing. The people that perfected Lean and Six Sigma, you're talking about Toyota in manufacturing. This is why they're able to put out for decades a better product than anybody. Because they implemented it. There's a way to implement this, but it required testing. It required me taking the chance and saying, no, let's not do it, and let's test and see if we can do it with just bait. And if we get the same result. For ant control, for us, for a crazy ant, ghost ant, big-headed ant, carpenter ant, white-footed ant, it made no sense because those ants weren't in a lot of cracking crevices. If we found the nesting site and we found the area they were trailing with, which is the bait in that area, it wiped it out. They did the work for us. So we found out later we could do it with stations. It reduced the us making application of gel bait in a lot of places where people are going to touch it. So when we make a brand product, a brand promise to the client that we won't unnecessarily contaminate that home with an unnecessary use of a pesticide. It's not that we don't use it. It's that we don't have to. I'm about, is it necessary? a lot of people, why wouldn't you do it? I said, my first question to you is it this? I get this question asked at least 2 to 3 times a week, sometimes on a daily basis. You know, would you add this product? Would you add that product? My question always is, why do you need it? Well, because I want it as an extra layer of protection. It says, how do you know it gives you an extra layer of protection? Have you tried not doing it for a year with all your clients and see what happens? See if your callbacks get stronger. See if, no, they don't. They're asking questions and they're debating with me. A lot of people, not James. A lot of people do a debate with me. Says, yeah, but I just feel, bro, that, but what is your feeling based on? Because we deal in science. We don't deal we deal in trial and error, research development. We deal in understanding insect biology. We deal in chemistry. We deal in science. Feelings are something we deal with the customer. So this is your USP. This is how you explain to the client why you're different than that other company, why it's more convenient to go with you even though they're going to pay more. The inconvenience of having inconvenience that client, inconvenience their whole day, spending, you know, people are busy. To tell somebody, oh yeah, you need to remove everything, like it's not your time. You remove it for the client and then bill them for it. That's a better USP. So, again, situation. Is it commercial? Can the client wait 14 days for a follow-up if it's not serious? What I discovered during the trials, when I read Deanie Miller, when I read a ton of stuff from Brenner at the USDA, trials being done in Boston and in HUD environments. You know that you can control roaches in a building with nothing more than IGR, and in a year's time, you will have control, but it will take a year. But you can do it with just spraying. If you want a baseboard spray and have low impact, IGR, you can do it with Gentrol. In 1 year, there's a study that proves it. Is the client willing to wait a year? But let me ask you this. You took on an infested building. The client is paying baseboard spray prices. Nobody's getting control. The last three companies didn't. If you just went and did a little bit with the gun, with Doxum and voids, and then applied IGR everywhere, wouldn't you get control? I'm asking. So these are the things that most people aren't willing to take the chance. They aren't willing to debating with me that it won't work when they've never done it. But guess what? I got to do it 88 times a week on 88 units for a year and seeing what worked and what didn't work and what we needed to change and modify, where we needed to put those monitors, put them next to the fridge, behind the fridge, underneath the fridge, underneath the stove, behind the stove. Stop sticking them underneath the freaking pipe with your brand so when the customer opens, he can see it and you're not catching any roaches. It doesn't work. A bunch of you large brands are doing stupid stuff like that. You know, you don't have it down to a science. Some of you got it down to stupidity. Sorry for the rant. So yeah, James, thank you very much for the question. Thank you for coming to me. I'm always happy to answer questions, even if you think it's a stupid question. Ask me the question. Because what I learned is there really is no stupid question. It might be an ignorant question, not knowing, but everybody knows nothing at one point. I'm still amazed on what I'm learning on a daily basis about biology and pest control. I have a video where we just had an ant problem where they build a new home. The ants were already inside. When they put the coating on the roof, the ants ate through the coating and caused the leak. And instead of calling me, he decided, I'm going to buy the guy some spray and so he can spray it around there and then coat it back up again. Guess what happened? After he paid the guy for doing all that and the roofing, the ants ate through again because they're like, hey, who covered up my nest? and they ate through it again. So I went in there, I baited them out. I'm going to go in and foam inject that now to make sure the gallery is dead, everything is dead, and then have them go in and do the recoating again. I put some stations, B and G stations around the roof because bait is going to knock them out no matter where they're at. We use liquid and granular. Going to go back in a week, inspect it, make sure they're not there. I used a Termitrack, believe it or not, to detect if the ants were in there. And it actually does detect the movement. If you knock on it and you cause them to move around, you can detect the movement with a Termitrack. Yeah, that's right. I took a $3,000 piece of equipment to figure out what the heck was in that hole. Thermal camera, trying to figure out, can I see something in there? What the heck is in there that we don't know because nobody knew? He said, no, they're ants. But he said, they look like those ghost ants. I says, ghost ants are never going to eat through a freaking rubber membrane. This takes something with a big mandible. Guess what it was? Big-headed ant. But I, your pest geek, will find it if it's in that house. There's no way my tech could have found it because he wasn't going to climb on a roof. He doesn't carry a 14-foot ladder. I don't let my guys climb on roofs. We just don't do it because it requires a lot of experience and ladder training. And there's no way I'm putting a 24-year-old guy on a roof who's never been on a roof with no ladder training, no experience running around with me for a year walking on a roof, even if it's a flat roof. I'm not putting him up there. I'm not taking the chance. So I did it. I went up there. I looked at it, found it, going to solve it. So, guys, send me your questions. Go ahead and message me personally. If you've got a question you're afraid to ask that you think is dumb, that nobody's going to answer. If I don't know the answer, I know who does. Actually, I consulted somebody on it. I won't tell because, you know, he doesn't. I don't know if he wants to be bothered with that kind of stuff. But, you know, I have a little relationship with him, and I appreciate it. What we actually thought it could have been is Formosa termite, that somebody left a piece of wood because the outer edge of that they built that frame in an outer edge, is actually a wood composite product with glue. And I said, well, maybe it's Formosa termite. They were already there. And then they're coming out and, you know, they can eat a hole through that membrane to come out. Well, this little ant on a $10,000 roof job made the living lights impossible, life impossible for this roofer and for this homeowner. Now, this is a several million dollar home. This thing is expensive, yet to have a roof leak because of an ant. That's a brand new construction. It's less than 2 years old. I've been doing that house for a year and a half now, 2 years. We used to do their other house. We started doing it here. This is the stuff, guys, that the large companies aren't going to solve. This is why we charge the big bucks. This is why we charge more, because when a customer really has a problem, they're going to get a true professional out there that's actually going to find the problem and solve it. And that's what you should be doing. That's why you should be raising your prices. And I'm going to be talking about that on the next edition. Hey, this is Frank the Pest Geek, wishing you a pestacular day.